Hello, everybody. I am pleased to chair this session on our journey together on PAO transformation and evolution. As we all know, preparing a future-ready profession is one of the key strategic objectives for IFAC and the profession. And during our CEO forum of last year in New York, none of us would have imagined that 1 year later, that is today, we would not be able to meet physically, and we would have to adapt by organizing a virtual forum. During this last year, our capacity to adapt, to navigate in uncertainty, and to remain agile has been challenged in unprecedented ways. And we are all happy to realize today how we managed in these challenging times, each one of us on her or his own way. And as Tejinder from IOSCO said yesterday, it has been a real stress test for most of our organizations. Adaptability and transformation are therefore becoming the new norm for us that we will need to champion continuously as individuals, as organizations, as societies, and as countries. So the question is, what more can we do to equip ourselves at the PAO's level with the right tools to thrive through changes and prepare ourselves for a better future? What are the lessons that we learned from this past exceptional year? These are some of the questions we shall try to get some insights on by listening to the experiences of our speakers and panelists. But before giving the floor to our panelists, let me also highlight some of the actions that IFAC has taken and is taking in this regard. And I shall only mention a few. During 2020, IFAC spent a great deal of time engaging on PAO sustainability through several things: IFAC's COVID-19 survey and engagement with member organizations, through forums and discussions, as well as IFAC's stakeholder survey. And all of these pointed out the importance of the topics that we are covering today. Also, IFAC developed specific initiatives in response to the global pandemic to help support our member organizations be future ready. And these initiatives included things like our COVID-19 web pages and resources, plus the continuing professional development resource web page, plus the PAO digital transformation series, plus the online examination series, etc., etc. Also, our PAO development and advisory group is embracing this opportunity and established a working group focused on PAO sustainability. So as we have always underlined it, as a global convener, IFAC depends heavily on its network, including yourselves, in sharing knowledge and resources. And to make the right impact, we need to feed each other with our experiences and resources. And this is why we are having this session today. So today we will start with a panel of accountancy organization leaders to help set the scene and share with us how they have engaged on several strategic topics, such as revenue diversification and growth, well-being and resiliency of people, relevance and reputation, member and stakeholder engagement, and digitalization of operations and services. We will then hear three case studies of how PAO leaders have made important changes to identify opportunities to strengthen their organizations and ensure a sustainable future. We will then turn to you all for your active participation with the panel and presenters for questions and answers. And I encourage you all to share with us your stories on innovations and the lessons and difficulties you encounter. We would also love for you to present your story on our knowledge gateway, as well as share any resources that can help our entire community of PAOs to transform and evolve together. So without any further delay, I shall first call on three of our colleagues whom you already know. We will first hear from Barry Melancon, Chief Executive Officer of AICPA, then Helen Brand, Chief Executive of ACCA, and Dr. Chen Yugui, President of CAPA.
Thank you, Asmâa. Thank you so much to be with you. I enjoy being on this panel. 5 minutes or so that we're each going to give you sort of a scene setting with Helen and Dr. Chen. And so I'll jump right into it. I want to build off of really the opening remarks that Alan and Kevin gave us yesterday, in which he said, you know, as a profession and professional bodies, we've done a good job in this very difficult time. And I think that's true. But I think that the real change management that we as bodies and in the profession will have to deal with is just really beginning. And we've certainly dealt with a lot of change over the last couple of decades, but the speed of that change is going to accelerate now in a post-pandemic. During the chat, during the break before this, people were talking about the ability for us to gather throughout the world. This speed and agility will be a major test of our organizational structures and even the relationship with our stakeholders, our members, as well as the public. Because we are a profession, and I asked the question in the earlier topic about standard setting, we're a profession that has this notion of absolute getting it right, but we have a world that is moving at a much different pace, and we have to make sure we are not out of sync with that particular environment. So speed and agility will be absolutely the most important part. I think we've demonstrated that in the past year, but I think it will kick up. I was on a session just a couple of weeks ago in which we're talking about blockchain, which is a technology that we tend to talk about in futuristic terms as it relates to some of the audit issues, or really maybe present terms at the most. But the quote was that blockchain feels ancient. It's like the printing press. And if you think about the concept of the technologies that we're dealing with today, what we might have been imagining way off in 2025 have really been contracted into 2021 and 2 and 3. And so the relevance of us as a profession and the relevance as member bodies that serve that profession, I think, will be very much put to test. And the change in the profession will be profound. I think we have to look at ourselves with really critical mirrors and saying, are we structured? Are we agile enough to look like the firms and how they are changing? We can look at the big four firms. We can look at the next tier firm, the networks and the association of firms that are out there. Rapid change in the services that they're delivering, their go-to-market strategies. Even we will see, I think, pretty significant changes in ownership structures of firms as we move forward. And how are we as organizations aligned to that? The more we become distanced from that, the less relevant that we will be. And I think the speed of all of that, again, will have been brought to a more rapid pace. Yesterday in the ESG discussions, there was another very important point made. And Kevin used the term in saying that it's ours to lose, but we will have a competition. And I think our ability to think about competition in all things that we do, from accountancy all the way to new and evolving services, I think will be really, really critical. the amount of competition will have sped up in this environment as well. And how we interact with that, how we propel the profession forward in those particular environments will be critical to our success, not only as a profession, but as organizations. And so I would say the other point that I would relate to yesterday is that sort of jokingly, Kevin and Lee White were talking about not getting too far as chief executives, too far ahead of their boards. And I think as leaders, and the predominance of people here are their chief executives, I think the need actually is there for senior executives, chief executives of organizations to push the envelope. Yes, it's risky. Yes, it takes more skill. Yes, it takes more passion and confidence in where you're going. But our member bodies are not really structured to be agile and forward thinking. I asked a question in the last session about how standard setting can become much more relevant and much faster. And Kevin's answer was fair that it's about the standard setting boards. But if you take an honest look at our profession, we are a relatively slow moving profession. We feel like we're moving very quickly today, but compared to the rest of the world, it is not really aligned. And I think that's our number one challenge as the profession and as member bodies, if we're going to be relevant going forward. And of course, we have to internally look at all of our operations from that, the digitization of everything. The connectivity is much different. Members, particularly younger members, will not be interested in large quantities of information about the profession. They're only going to be interested in that information that is most relevant to them at that point in time. And how we build our infrastructures, invest, is really critical to that. And that brings me to really the final point, that our own business models, and I spoke to this last year at this meeting when we were together collectively, our own business models have to change pretty radically, I believe, to be able to free up the resources to do the types of things that's necessary to lead the profession. We have a handful, maybe two handfuls, of very large networks of firms that are multiple billions of dollars of revenue. They are equipped to be able to deal with issues in a much more rapid way. And we are, as even if we look at IFAC's budget, as we look at our own budgets, we have to find different ways to create the resources to invest that's necessary in this fast-paced world. So I'll leave it with that. And I guess I would leave it with the notion of agility and speed being the number one challenge that we have going forward. Thank you.
And just before I start, thank you to Alan and Asma and Kevin and the entire IFAC team for putting on such a fantastic session. I think you've thought creatively about what being a digital forum means, and that's really critical in all this. So thank you for that. I was asked to talk just for a few minutes on two specific things, wellbeing and resilience and growth and diversification. But as I'm sure I don't need to tell anybody on this call, the integration of all the things we're talking about is incredibly important if we're going to have the right strategic outcomes for the profession. But I'll focus on those two just now. On wellbeing and resilience, I'll mainly talk about our own people, the people who work for ACCA and what we've been doing there and our experience there. But of course, that entire topic is incredibly important issue for members and students as well. And we've had to put a lot of effort into supporting the wellbeing of our members and students. And indeed, we now have a permanent wellbeing hub of resources to connect our members to what they need in this space. We're talking about our people. I think talking to many of you over the course of the year, we've all been massively impressed about how people have risen to the challenges of the global pandemic. And it's been wonderful to see the performance that has come forward in spite of all those challenges. So that's fantastic. But I guess the learning from that is, how do you create and then how do we maintain that environment that allows people to both cope and flourish and deliver those outstanding outcomes in the future? And I'd say there were three elements in particular that I'd call out. One being communication and engagement, secondly, policies and practices, and thirdly, diversity, inclusion and belonging. Starting on communication engagement, I mean, it's never been more important to be visible. And as leaders, I think that visibility with empathy has been absolutely critical to motivating teams and keeping them on track to deliver on that performance and to enhance their well-being. I think I've described a few times now as the democratization of participation. I think that's digital, you know, having these digital tools, whilst we all wish to have that face-to-face engagement again, and there'll be lots of benefits from that. Actually, the people that you can involve in decision-making, discussions, innovation, creativity, it's just so much more extensive now. And that really does bolster the confidence of both the individuals and the organization. So I think we need to hold on to that democratization as we move forward. I think clarity of focus as well in these times plays a huge part in people's well-being. Do they know where you're heading? Are they engaged in that? And are they able to identify the contribution that they can make? So we've been building up to launching a new strategy to 2025 on the 1st of April 2020. We'd identified our areas of strategic focus, and we had to totally pivot from that. We didn't throw it all away, but in terms of what we need people to do there and then and how we needed them to focus, at a very short time frame we had to pivot, and we did. And a lot of the feedback we've got is that the clarity of that focus really helped people to stay on track and understand what contribution they were going to make going forward. So in a broad bucket, I guess that's all around leadership, isn't it? And demonstrating that leadership. In terms of policies and practices, we've always had flexible working arrangements. And, you know, as a global organization, we've had to have lots of many different ways of interacting and getting the true value out of people's contribution for a long time. But that, again, we had to think again how we could extend that, how we could really react to the circumstances that people were facing. So whether it was the tech equipment or other equipment people needed to work from home, digital collaboration tools that we've been investing in for a long time, but, you know, really ramping up the training around that. We've smaller things, but things like emergency contacts being visible to managers. If you're working on your own at home and an incident happens, how does someone look after you? You know, in the workplace, physically, there would be a team to do that. So very small, but we had to work the whole thing through to support people. And then in January this year, we introduced 5 extra days wellbeing leave that was available to all people globally to apply for, just to see them, show that empathy, see them through a bit further in terms of organising themselves with caring for school-aged children, elderly people, ill people, all the pressures that were coming into, have come into play and remain in play for many others. And then, you know, continuous webinars, check-ins, making sure that managers had both the informal and formal touch points with people to ensure that they had a line of communication. And on the last point I raised, diversity and inclusion, I think we now know that that's very closely related to well-being. And although, and I will say, I think I had become complacent around those issues in terms of, you know, our value set, the diversity we saw within our organisation, maybe thinking, taking that for granted. But during the pandemic and in the light of Black Lives Matters movement, we ramped up significantly our focus on diversity and inclusion to create that sense of belonging and well-being. So I led listening sessions throughout the organisation to understand how people were feeling, what we could be doing better, how we could improve. And we've established now 3, you know, people-led communities. So it's not a line manager job, it's communities around well-being itself, ethnicity and LGBTQ plus, and making sure that I and my team, my direct reports, are closely involved in that, listening to what people need. And then taking for that into policies around training, data collection, which we've put a lot of emphasis on now, and a commitment that we've made to ethnicity pay gap reporting alongside gender pay gap reporting, which we've been doing for a number of years now. So I think people seeing those outcomes of that listening and actual policy action is making them feel reassured and integrated into the organisation and the effort that we're making. So that, some points around wellbeing, happy to explain more if anyone wants to ask questions. On growth and diversification, I mean, how long have we got? And I think the answer is about 1 minute. It all has to come back to what Barry was touching on, doesn't it? You can't grow or diversify without understanding the market need. And that goes back to relevance and reputation of the profession and what it is you're providing. And I didn't know what Barry was going to say, but I have here in front of me, I'd written in capital letters, build the capability to be agile. You know, if we can do anything, if we can invest in anything, then it is building that capability to respond in an agile fashion and a speedy fashion to the market that is changing so rapidly around us. So in the past year, I have worked very hard to protect us, what we call our strategic investment fund. It does maybe mean making harder choices in other areas, but making sure that you're continuing to protect the investment that provides that future and gives you that capability is absolutely critical. If there's one area which I've seen accelerate, I think we all knew this was coming, but for many years as organisations, we've talked about continuous professional development or professional development, whatever you might call it in your organisation. It's ramped up to a level never seen before, I think, in terms of what it is that members require from us and that governments actually and societies and businesses require for us in terms of upskilling and reskilling people. So that means being much more agile in terms of the learning and certification opportunities that are available to our members and the broader business community. We know now 80% plus of our members say they look first to their professional body to provide that kind of support in terms of relevance and upskilling. And we have to have the capacity to respond to that. The other capability we're placing a lot of attention on here is partnerships. No single organisation is going to meet that market need, whether you're talking about product, operations, thought leadership, the future vision for the profession. That all has to be delivered through key partnerships and understanding what they are, innovating in your partnerships. So not thinking about the usual suspects is going to be really key in terms of growth and diversification. And finally, to grow, we have to attract people into the profession. You know, Gen Z are entering the workforce. And my great hope here is our emphasis on public value. I think that people starting their careers now want to know that they are delivering something that is meaningful in terms of the societies that they live in. Yesterday's discussion about sustainability in its broadest sense. And I think the ethical, dynamic profession that we can all present will be a way and, give us some certainty that pipeline of highly talented people continue to come into the profession, but we have to focus our communications in an authentic way to make sure that the reality of that is understood by the next generation. So I'll leave it there, Asmâa.
Hello, thank you, Asmâa, for the introduction. It is indeed a real pleasure to be invited to provide some opening remarks for this session in my role as President of the Confederation of Asian and Pacific Accountants, or CAPA. Specifically, I have been asked to share some findings from a recent survey we conducted at CAPA with our members in late 2020, and in particular, our findings in relation to the outlook for PAO sustainability and strengths in PAO digital transformation. The survey involved nearly 50 participants representing 25 member PAOs, or approximately 80% of our members, which included PAOs in Asia, Oceania, North America, and our affiliate members in the UK. Firstly, in terms of the outlook for PAO sustainability, various elements of the survey gave some insights into this. Here are five statistics. 70% were either a little or much more optimistic about the future of the profession and the future of PAOs than they were a year ago, pre-COVID. Only 10% showed a concern for the future. Two, 75% expected new member growth rates to either increase or stay the same in the short term. Three, 80% expected member retention rates to either increase or stay the same in the short term. Four, 70% expected student registrations to either increase or stay the same in the short term. Five, 75% expected PAO financial stability to either improve or remain the same in the medium to longer term. What does all of this mean based on the statistics, but also on discussion of these outcomes during the meeting? We deducted the following. Firstly, there was genuinely a sense of optimistic, and this was more than just cautious optimism. It appeared to be to reflect accelerated changes taking place, which I will discuss in a moment, and the opportunities being seized. Secondly, if student registration hold up in the short term, this should bode well for the medium and longer term. Thirdly, existing members do not seem to be giving up their membership more than usual. Fourthly, CBD revenues may be holding up better than expected with some PAOs witnessing large attendances at events, albeit for lower attendance less. This can be somewhat offset by managing costs, and many PAOs have focused hard on containing or reducing operational costs, whilst still seeking to innovate and invest. But lastly, this bright outlook does not apply to all. Like with other consequences of COVID, there is a risk that some PAOs will be left behind. This could be in jurisdictions where the economic impact has been severe, or in less developed PAOs without the necessary technology infrastructure that is required now and into the future. It is important that we seek to understand the challenges being faced. Let me now turn to the second element I was asked to speak to, being the trends in PAO digital transformation. Here are statistics from two areas covered by the survey. First, less than 5% expect to deliver CPD only or mainly in person by 2024. However, just over 5% expect to deliver it only online. Just over 45% expect to deliver mainly online, and just under 45% expect to share delivery between online and in-person. Second, the pattern for the delivery of examinations by 2024 was slightly different. 15% expect to deliver examinations only or mainly in-person. In contrast, 45% expect to deliver examinations only or mainly online. It appears quite a number of PAOs are ready to commit to using the technology to deliver examinations, but some are not in the position to do so. In contrast, technology is being used significantly to deliver CPD, but a move forward towards delivering only online is unlikely. Amongst other reasons, this may reflect the associated benefit of networking during COVID, CPD. It is clear that the COVID pandemic has accelerated the trend towards digital transformation in these two areas of CPD and the examinations. Other areas are also being impacted, such as the move to online magazines and journals. However, our survey did not cover this. Some of these observations may not be new. However, it is interesting to attempt to undertake some quantitative and analysis to support what may otherwise be subjective observations. These and other outcomes from this survey have been documented and can be found in the article published on the IFAC Knowledge Gateway just a few weeks ago. So thank you. I will finish it there and hand back to Asmâa.